morning. Welcome to the International Spy Museum. I recognize most of you immediately. You're such a great crowd. We always welcome you. You're always a pleasure to have. And I want to particularly thank and compliment the Smithsonian. It is a pleasure to partner with the Smithsonian. And I want to thank in particular the program coordinator, whom many of you know, Mary McLaughlin, and the docents who come here and give of their services. I'm so delighted to see them here. I'd like to thank them particularly for their presence. And they're often here when Mary McLaughlin is not. So I think of sort of, there are Smithsonian spies right here in the house, okay, along with Mary. As a courtesy to the speakers, if you'd be kind enough to turn off your cell phones, any electronic, it can interfere with the cameras. This is the ninth in our series with the Smithsonian. I'm the executive director of the Spy Museum, Peter Ernest, and our speaker today. Oh, and I would like to make one reference before I go on. As you know, this is a month of romance, right? This is Valentine's, hence the program we're having today, all the about swingers. I talked to the film crew back there, and they said, yeah, we're going to record this, and we're going to play it after hours. So, okay, fine. At any rate, I did want to draw your attention to the fact I know you've signed up for the series, but there are flyers back there. And on February 11th is the program Sexpionage, Spies, Lies, and Naked Thighs. And that is done by Keith Melton, who is on our advisory board, has the largest private collection in the world of spy gear and very knowledgeable on spy technology and methodology. So, having said that, let me address our speaker today. Is Jonna Mendez, someone whom I've known for a number of years. I should mention right off the bat, I see Jonna quite regularly. She is on the board of advisors of the International Spy Museum, and she and her husband, Tony, whom many of you know from his fame in particular from Argo. And Tony could not be with us today, but we're delighted to have Jonna here. Jonna began her career overseas in Germany, where she was working and was recruited by CIA in 1966. And at the time, they brought her into she became a technical operations officer. Often technical operations officers often are cross-trained in a variety of things. In Jonna's case, she was trained in disguise, identity transformation, and clandestine imaging. I will let her explain that if any of you are interested in that. But her really top specialties were photography and disguise. She was assigned in the mid-80s, 1986, to what in the agency we called denied area operations. They were called that because of the absolutely pervasive surveillance that we had to deal with in Russia, our principal adversary, and East Europe. And it was so pervasive, we had to develop very special techniques. We became very good at communicating with our agents, our secret sources, even under surveillance. And Tony and Jonna helped facilitate that. Jonna herself was made chief of disguise at the CIA, running that multi-million-dollar program. There are a variety of people who are tech ops folks who are around the world. And she then retired from the agency in 1933, receiving the intelligence. All right, we'll take it from the top. Okay, all right. She shook her head and then you all reacted, okay. She retired in 1993 and earning the CIA's Intelligence Commendation Medal. Since then, she has exhibited her photography work, which she now does, at a variety of places. It's on exhibit and at their home in Maryland. She and Tony have lectured in a variety of places, world affairs councils, colleges, and so forth. She is a regular appearer here on either a panel or as a single lecturer. And I will mention one book. I think this was your first book, actually, Spy Dust. It's about their years in Moscow, the denied area operations. This is where you, I think, first hear the term Moscow rules. And it is used, this book, Spy Dust, often with new intelligence personnel coming into the community, coming into the agency. It's that good, and it covers that many operations. So I have said enough. Jonna, it's delightful to have you here. Please help me welcome Jonna Mendez.
Well, good morning. There's no better way to start the day than to be introduced by Peter. It's inspiring. In another life, in another time, I lived in DC and I was a Smithsonian resident associate. I did so many programs with the Smithsonian. Once we moved out of Washington, DC into the countryside, an hour and a half from here, where it's beautiful, where the Blue Ridge Mountains are rolling, where there's no traffic, there are some things I miss. I miss Trader Joe's. I miss the bustle of the city, actually, and I miss these kinds of events sponsored by the Smithsonian. There's no way to replicate them out there. So it's good to see these faces. You're not familiar to me, but your programs are very familiar to me. Just to follow up a bit on what Peter was saying, I spent most of my adult life working for the Central Intelligence Agency. I went to Europe when I was 20. I went over there to be in my friend's wedding in Germany. And I never went home. Home was Kansas. We didn't have hills and trees and green grass in Kansas, and I stayed. And I did start working for the CIA overseas. Came back to Washington, D.C., worked for them back here, and then it was a series of overseas and back home, overseas and back home. It was a way to see the world. I highly recommend it. We have mentored a lot of young people into the CIA. It's a profession. It's an honorable profession. It's a great place to work and participate, to give back something to your country. I'm so proud of having served there. Having said all that, let's talk about some of the people that we were working against, some of the enemies that we were confronting, some of the techniques that they were using, some of the techniques that we used to try and stop them or at least nullify what they had done. In this lead up to Valentine's Day, I get Hana Koecher as a subject. Hana was one of the most attractive, really a beautiful blue-eyed blonde Czechoslovakian intelligence officer working in the United States. She's an elusive woman to track down. She was part of a team. She and her husband came as a unit, and they worked as a unit, and they left as a unit. So we'll get into the story. You might discover somewhere along the way here, while I'm delivering a PowerPoint presentation, PowerPoint is not my friend. There's a young man in the back of this room named Memphis. Memphis is my friend. So we'll start out.
The first foreign agent ever planted inside the CIA was arraigned today in a New York court. Karl Koecher was born in Czechoslovakia 50 years ago, charged today with passing U.S. secrets and the names of intelligence agents to his communist homeland. The FBI said he was trained since youth to become a Czech mole inside the CIA. He worked for the agency from 1973.
From 1973 for 20 years. He worked in the United States, Karl Koecher did, for 20 years, spying for the Czechoslovakian intelligence service, which meant spying for the KGB and the Russians, because it was a direct line. It went through Czechoslovakia, but his real masters were back in Moscow. Koecher was a very interesting man. He was an intellectual. He was firmly pro-communist in his beliefs. He was born in Bratislava in 1934. He was hired by the Czechoslovakian intelligence service relatively early to come to the United States and to be a mole, to be one of these sleeper agents. You've all sat and watched in the news. You've watched the ten moles that were arrested. Most recently, we had three more. God knows how many there are left, but there are probably a lot. Well, Karl and Hana Koecher were two of those. They came, they embedded themselves in American society, and they proceeded to wreak some devastation while they pretended to be other than they were. He started out in Czechoslovakia as a comedy writer for a radio show. This was a really smart man, but when he was young, he joined the Communist Party, and his bride-to-be, Hana, she also joined the Communist Party. That's not quite as devastating as it might sound, because it was expected of young people at that time in communist societies that they would be party members. So we gave away the punchline with the very first slide. You know that they were arrested in 1984. They had 3 years of intelligence training in Czechoslovakia with the specific goal of coming and burrowing into American society. They didn't come directly from Czechoslovakia. That would have been too easy. That might have set off some flags. So the first thing they did is they left Czechoslovakia and they went to Austria. They went to Vienna. And when they did come to the United States, they immigrated from Vienna. Well, some people, Peter would be one, would be a little suspicious of Vienna, because Vienna has to be one of the spy capitals of the world. There's so much activity that goes on there, historically and even today. They came in 1965. They showed up in the United States and presented themselves. This was a staged defection. Karl Koecher said, "We are being persecuted in our home country because we are anti-communists. We've been driven out of our country because I speak up against communism, and now I can't get a job. They're going to put me in jail, and I have fled my home country. And I'm coming to the shores of America, home of democracy, to start a new life." Right. Well, it works. By 1971, he had become a United States citizen. 1971. He had become a United States citizen. And in the 70s and the 80s, he became an employee of the CIA. It's not easy to become an employee of the CIA. Anybody who's joined recently will tell you that it's enormous background checks. To become a US citizen, the background check can only go back to that day that they landed on our shores. CIA security does not go knocking on the doors of your ex-neighbor in Czechoslovakia. They don't go interviewing your former employer in Czechoslovakia. And so it's a little trick in the system that the security check can't really go back that far. And that's one reason the CIA has always been so leery about hiring foreign-born citizens, because there's a little room for mischief in there, and Hana Koecher certainly took advantage of that. He was 28 when he joined the Czechoslovakian intelligence service. He married Hana, who was also a member already of the intelligence service and already a member of the Communist Party. Interestingly, I think the day of their wedding was November 22nd, 1963. Does it ring a bell? Yeah, they got married the day that Kennedy was assassinated. So they completed their intelligence training, which would have involved a lot of tradecraft. It would have involved a lot of language skills. When Karl Koecher came out of Czechoslovakia, he was fluent in four languages. Of course, he spoke Czech. He was fluent in English. You'll hear him speak later in a video. His English is very, very good. He was fluent in French. And most importantly, he was fluent in Russian. You have to you have to remind yourself, because you know this already, but Americans are not good with languages. It's a hole in the fabric of this society. We don't speak foreign languages. We pretty much expect everybody else to speak English. And to a large extent, that works. But if you have a real skill in a foreign language, it will get you very far in this country. And in today's world, the more exotic the language, the more valuable it is, of course. So if you speak Farsi today, fluently, natively, for instance, you can find a job quite easily. So they had this staged defection after they were married. Hana was 10 years younger than her husband. He was 31, she was 21. They come to the United States. They're already spies when they set foot on this on these shores. But they have a little work to do because they've just shown up. But now they're going to have to establish themselves as good citizens of this country. So the first thing that they do, Karl gets a job at Radio Free Europe. It's perfect. His language skills are excellent. He's building, actually, a dossier. He's building his current past for the CIA's consumption, because his goal is to get that job at the CIA. Hana actually got a different kind of a job. Hana ended up working in the diamond industry in New York City. She worked off and on for Harry Winston. Some of you in here may even have a Harry Winston on your ring, I don't know. But that was her job that gave her incredible flexibility in traveling the world, going almost anywhere, and moving back and forth, say to Europe, say to Switzerland, which was one of her favorite places, carrying large sums of money. She was a diamond merchant. Of course she was carrying large sums of money. Karl also went to school here, and he ended up getting a doctorate at Columbia University. So he's got his Radio Free Europe. He's got his scholarship that he can fall back on. He went to Wagner College in Staten Island, working in the philosophy department. So they're building this file for the CIA to review. He got his citizenship in 71. Hana got her citizenship in 72. I love this first bullet. Zbigniew Brzezinski. Wouldn't Mika just cringe to know this? As part of this package that he was building, he posed as a virulently anti-communist guy. That's why he had left home. That's why he couldn't get work in his home country. And when he was here, that was one of the things that he would rant about. And Karl Koecher was a ranter. He would get on a subject and you couldn't get him off of it. He wouldn't leave it alone. But when the subject was fake, it really becomes kind of interesting. So he was anti-communist. He was also anti-Jewish, and he would go on and on. He was an outspoken, noisy, loud anti-Semite, but he was Jewish. This is part of the deal. This is part of what he's building. He was half Jewish. The other half was Catholic. Guess what? He was also anti-Catholic. So everyone that ever met him heard him speak against communism, Judaism, and Catholicism. This was the persona that he was building as he was making his way. So he's establishing what we call his bona fides for American consumption, a fake dissident, fake anti-communist, and a fake religious zealot. How's that for a package? Now I have to say that it worked, because after several years he was hired by the CIA. But there was another side to Karl Koecher that was not so much for public consumption, but it was very much about his job as a Czechoslovakian intelligence officer collecting intelligence, collecting information, going out and putting out a dragnet to see how many contacts he could make that were in high places, or at least places where the information he wanted was. And one of the tacks that he and Hana took was this swinging 60s sexual underworld that was going on in Washington, D.C. It's interesting, I was telling Peter before we started talking, during this time that they were having all of these parties and these group sex clubs, and there's more to come of this, I was working at the CIA. And the Koechers say that CIA employees, at least 10 of them, were very much involved in this kind of activity. And people from the Pentagon, and a U.S. senator, and all these high-level government officials, which when I first heard this, I didn't believe it. I thought, oh, this is, somebody's written a story to make a splash in some newspaper. But the more you read about it, the more real it becomes. And a man named Ron Kessler has written a book. Actually, it's an old book. It's 1988. It's called Spy Versus Spy. And after the arrest and after the Koechers are back in Czechoslovakia, Kessler went and interviewed them for 5 days. And amazingly, Karl Koecher was very, very frank with him and substantiates all of this and then adds more. So I feel comfortable presenting this as the way it was back in the day. I have done some work for a man named David Major. He had a company called CI Center that did a lot of training for the Central Intelligence Agency. This is a story about the Koechers and about Washington, D.C., and a restaurant called the Exchange. There was a restaurant down on G Street near the White House, and there was a group that met there. They were called the Capital Couples. People would literally come in after work, and they'd the young people today would say they'd hook up. They'd find their partner for the evening or for the next hour or for whatever, and off they'd go. This was official Washington, D.C., in the heart of the city, a couple of blocks from the White House, and this is all going on. Well, the Koechers are right in the middle of this. It is an opportunity for them to have access to people who had information that they were interested in. There's such a thing as pillow talk. Talking comes in somewhere along the line, and they could elicit a little bit of information here and there. But think about it. Not just information. They now had little leverage with the people that they're meeting with, the people that they're leaving with, the people maybe they're spending the night with. Leverage in terms of blackmailability, possibly. Because people that were doing this weren't doing it in the open, not really. This was done quietly after work, after hours. You didn't take this kind of activity into work. And so the Koechers, just by definition, had the goods on some of these people they were meeting with. And Karl Koecher was all about making this network that was going to work for him, give him the information that he and Prague and Moscow wanted. They loved Washington, D.C., the sex capital of the world, they called it. I didn't make this stuff up. Capital Couples, that was at the Exchange restaurant. Saturday nights, they were there. A place called Virginia's In Place, which was further out in the suburbs in Virginia. Meetings in hotels and private homes. 10 members were bona fide CIA. There were Pentagon officials. There were reporters from major newspapers. If there are any reporters in here from a major newspaper, I'm sorry, but you're being wrapped up in this. And one U.S. senator. This could absolutely change your view of your government at work. Hana served as a kind of bait, because Hana was absolutely stunning. She was gorgeous. And to show up at one of these things with Hana on your arm, at least going in the door, you know, Hana probably came out of this with more information, more useful information than he did. Also, Hana was the enthusiastic one in these proceedings. I do recommend Spy Versus Spy if you are home on a quiet Saturday night and want some juicy reading. Hana was quite the date. Hana was working up in New York City. He was working down here in Washington, D.C. They were commuting back and forth to see each other. They were commuting back and forth to pass documents. She would go overseas, pick up payment from their spy masters, bring it back to Washington, D.C. to drop it off. And of course, this commute had very much to do with sex parties. Not just here in D.C., also up in New York, where you can imagine there's probably 10 more of these places. That's what it looked like on the outside. It's not there anymore. Thank God. So to sum up, in 71, Karl becomes a U.S. Citizen. The next year, Hana joins him. Now they're both citizens, which is important because at the CIA, they want your spouse to be a U.S. citizen. He applies for a staff work with the CIA. He passes a polygraph because, of course, he had been trained in how you go about passing that polygraph. And in 1973, they moved to the Washington, D.C. area. His office was in Roslyn, the office that he worked in. And they lived in Falls Church. So there they are. They could be your next-door neighbors. They might have been one of your next-door neighbors, and you probably wouldn't have known that. He worked for the CIA from 73 to 75 in Washington, D.C. And then later, he's promoted, and they moved to New York City. Now, one of the things, Peter, is this hard for you to understand? He was granted a top secret clearance with what they call SCI access. That's a lofty security clearance. SCI stands for Special Compartmented Information. It is one of the most sensitive compartmented projects that there is, and Karl had access to that. With that, he had access to almost everything. And he began work as a staff translator. He was working for SE Division, that's Soviet and East European Division. The translating would have been all the Eastern European languages. But primarily, I would say the emphasis would be on Russian. He'd be listening to audio tapes. He'd be reading transcripts. He'd be looking at some of the photography of classified documents that had been gathered by agents working for the CIA. He would be putting all of it into readable English. It's such a sensitive place for an asset to be parked, and it's just kind of amazing that he got that kind of access. In 1976, the CIA started to get a sense that something was not quite right. They began to have a feeling that he might be leaking a little bit of information, and they started giving him less and less work. And this time, as a matter of fact, he had such restricted access that he didn't even contact his Czechoslovakian intelligence service for 3 years. He's being a mole, right? He was quiet. He went quiet. The CIA is acting a little suspicious, so he stops doing what he's doing, except for the sex clubs. And he just kind of goes to ground. He's very, very quiet. Then in 1982, the FBI started having some suspicions about Karl Koecher. And what caught their attention was they were not looking for him. They were watching known Czechoslovakian intelligence officers in Washington, D.C. That's their job. They were doing surveillance on Czechoslovakian intel officers. They were listening to their phones. They were bugging some places that they went. That's the FBI's job. And they kept bumping into Karl Koecher. So they started watching Koecher very closely. And they started seeing what were recognizably what we call brush passes, where you're on a street and you're just doing this and there's something in your hand. It's like passing a baton. You don't see it when it's done right. Right, Peter? You don't see it at all. He was having brief encounters with these people, just very quick, short, and on. And then they noticed that Hana was also behaving a little oddly. Hana was picking up some dead drops for Karl Koecher. Hana was also doing some brush passes. Then they start listening to the telephone, and pretty soon the FBI gets a very good sense that they've got a working operational case here, that they might be looking at two moles. Karl was actually let go by the CIA in 1977. You have to understand that to let someone like that, to let them go and to get rid of them is a highly strategic kind of decision, because you don't want to spook them. You don't want them to do what Ed Howard did and run for the hills. You want to be able, if you're the FBI, to build a case that you could take to court and prosecute. You want to arrest these people. You want to prosecute them. It was a very delicate dance there at the end. Karl, while he was having job difficulties and he was looking for a job, Hana was still doing her diamond thing. She was at 30 West 47th Street. She actually set up a company, a diamond import company. Hana's having a great time. Karl doesn't have a job now. So Hana had a very, very good reputation in the diamond industry. Karl was a little up and down. People that got to know him pretty much didn't like him. Hana became so American, it was really hard to separate her out from the rest of the crowd. When she lived in New York, when they lived in New York, they were living the life. They lived in a high-rise building. It was on, I think it was on 87th Street. It was the same, it was the St. Regis at 50 East 89th Street in Manhattan. Their neighbors were Mel Brooks, the actor, Evan Lindell, the tennis player, Anne Bancroft. This was a ritzy building that they lived in. And true to form, living his cover, Koecher is on the condominium board of directors and is vehemently denying Evan Lindell's request to buy an apartment, because he said Lindell was a communist and he didn't want a communist in his building. He made a huge deal out of this. Lindell prevailed and Lindell moved into the building, but still. Hana, in the meantime, is every day getting up. She's running in Central Park. She's going to the Guggenheim. They're going to plays. They're going out and about. She's making quiche. She's watching 60 Minutes. She's reading all the best books. She has a book club. Hana became so American that, I mean, the great tragedy of her life, I'm sure, today, when Hana looks over her shoulder, is that she had to leave New York City and go back to Prague, where there isn't a Trader Joe's or a Dean and DeLuca or any of that stuff. She's back to pretty basic stuffs. But when they were in New York City, they took their swinging lifestyle with them. But they expanded it, because up in New York City, they had nudist camps. And they loved to go there. They went to the Playboy Club to have drinks. They were all over the place. They were meeting with other swingers. They were coming back down to Washington, D.C., because he's lost his CIA access, but he hasn't lost access to the people that he's met in his after-hours activities. The FBI watched them for 2 years. From bugs and surveillance, they knew, for instance, they could tell you what Hana did on June 3rd, 1984. They could tell you that on June 6th, they visited another swinging couple in Westchester County. They can tell you that the next day they went to a place called Rock Lodge, which was a nudist colony in New Jersey. At other times, they went to something called Pine Tree Associates. Don't you guys write this down. That's in Annapolis. I'm sure it's gone by now. But they were very much on top of them. But here it starts getting a little tricky, because if David Major, an ex-FBI officer, was standing next to me, he'd tell you that it's really hard to make an espionage case. You can have circumstantial evidence all over the place. But unless you can prove in a court that this piece of information was given to that person who didn't have authority to receive it, you cannot prevail. So prosecuting a case like this is really, really hard. Their hand was pushed, though, because they learned through telephone intercepts in June of 84 that the Koechers were planning on leaving the United States. They were going to go back to Europe. They told all their friends and neighbors were going back to Austria. Karl said, I've got a job there in a construction company. This is not working out. I'm having trouble finding work. I'm going to go back to Austria. I'm going to work there. And we're going to sell our condominium. So they put it on the market. This is 1984. They bought it for $40,000 10 years before. They sold it for $240,000. That was going to be their seed money to get back to Europe and get reorganized. Anyway, their friends never, ever had a clue that they were working for a foreign government, that they were collecting intelligence. They never, ever knew, which is how it's supposed to be. But the FBI is in a bind because they're going to leave. And once they leave these shores, there is no hope of prosecuting either one of them. So the FBI had to do something. They had to arrest them. They were hoping that they would arrest them, that they would interview them, that Karl would confess, and that they could make a case. That was all they were going to get out of it. And so, in fact, they did arrest them. They arrested them in 1984. After 20 years here in America, they're getting ready to fly back home. But Karl didn't exactly confess, and they didn't actually make the case because there were some mistakes made. This story that I'm telling comes from an FBI account of it. And so, of course, it has the CIA making the mistakes. But I have a feeling that this is how it actually happened. The FBI is in the job of apprehending, taking to court, getting prosecutions for a crime. The CIA is in an entirely different business. The CIA is in that business of following a lead to where it goes, never really apprehending, but trying to get back to the source, to the truth, to what has really happened. So the CIA and the FBI are always a little bit at odds. One of them is talking more about bank robbers. The other one is talking a little bit more about not arrests, but finding the truth. But what happened with the Koechers, evidently, is there was an interview after they were arrested. And promises were made to them, verbal promises were made to them, that if they helped in the case, if they would just fess up and help out in this case, that they would go free, that they would be allowed to go free. And because of that, once this got into court, it couldn't move forward. The prosecutor of this case for the United States government was Rudy Giuliani, back when he was the public attorney for New York. And Giuliani, I think, must have been tied in a knot because he didn't really have anywhere to go with this. They tried to charge Koecher with this Section 794. They held Hana as a material witness. She was never charged. They were held without bond for 2 years. But the case could not be made. They were never taken to trial. In the end, the way it worked out was a trade was arranged. And this was one of those spy exchanges that they did in Berlin on the Galienicke Bridge. And Hana and Karl Koecher were traded for Sharansky. Anybody remember that? Mm-hmm. Anton Sharansky. Soviet dissident. Both of them actually considered very high value by their respective sides. It was an indication, I think, to the United States government that high level of a trade could be made for the Koechers. And it gave, I think, the United States government a sense of what the Koechers had been able to do while they were here. And we'll talk about that in just a moment. When they went back to Prague, they received a hero's welcome. Huge cheers. Crowds lined the streets. There was a parade. They were given a brand new Volvo. They were given a villa outside of Prague. They were to restart the rest of their life in Prague. Now, Ron Kessler, the author who wrote the book Spy vs. Spy, went to Prague and had a week of interviews with Karl Koecher. It was amazing because he's still an active Czechoslovakian intelligence officer. It's almost unprecedented that he would speak to a journalist, to an author, while he was actively engaged. And he admitted as much. But he was very frank with Ron Kessler and in talking about what he had accomplished, what he had not accomplished. I'm going to play next a video, I hope, Memphis, a video of Koecher speaking out, Andropov speaking out, Oleg Kalugin, who is a board member at this museum but used to be head of counterintelligence for the KGB, speaking out. And in all of that, you get a peek at what we always called the wilderness of mirrors. It's a series of accusations and counter-accusations about who was actually telling the truth and what was really going on here. In this video, the Russians are accusing Oleg Kalugin, our lovely board member, the youngest KGB general ever. Have any of you met Oleg? Well, you will like this. They're accusing him of being a CIA plant, a CIA infiltration of the KGB. They said all the time that he was working for the KGB, he was actually working for the CIA. Of course, Oleg Kalugin denies that. He talks about Karl Koecher and what a villain he was and what a hard-hearted man he was. It is it's a breathtaking bit of film, and we will see if we can get it to play. They said when they were walking across the bridge in Berlin, Hana Koecher is wearing a white mink coat and a white mink hat for this exchange, and that she looked like a movie star, which I'm sure was the goal. Okay, here we go.
Almost from the moment Koecher had first entered the CIA, questions had been raised in Moscow about his loyalty. At the KGB, there were people who doubted the truthfulness of his reports. They began to wonder whether Mr. Koecher, after 10 years of easy living in the West, had changed sides. Koecher was asked to return to Prague. He was smuggled across the border and taken to a safe house in the countryside, where he met the man who had been sent from Moscow to investigate him, Oleg Kalugin.
Koecher was tense in the beginning. I introduced myself as a senior official of the KGB in counterintelligence business. Maybe I shouldn't have said that, because he definitely felt nervous. When you deal with the counterintelligence, you expect something unpleasant things.
Kalugin had brought with him some pictures that Koecher himself had provided, pictures that identified CIA agents with whom Koecher had worked, with the names of those agents written on the back.
That was a very simple investigative trick. You show your interlocutor a picture of someone and say, listen, I forgot, what's his name, by the way? Well, you know his name. You would expect your partner to immediately mention a name. And I was amazed. Koecher would not know these people. I gave him another picture. I said, listen, this picture, well, here is one name you gave, but how about this one? And he would not remember again. Well, that made me feel, weird. I thought, well, Jesus, what's going on? How come he gave us these pictures? He put the names of these people on the back of the picture. Now he doesn't even know, doesn't remember. Who put the names of these individuals? Maybe it was someone else. Maybe it was the CIA. Maybe he's a CIA plant. these thoughts inevitably, you know, came to my mind, and I felt a little uneasy with this man.
I couldn't remember the particulars he wanted to know.
And of course, this is Koecher.
I believe he was really trying to put me in a position which would allow him to accuse me that I was playing a double game, that I was really a traitor, working for the CIA against the Soviet Union, and that's what he told the Czechs. And of course, the KGB general was a supreme authority.
I said, listen, this is your guy. After all, you handle him. He was yours from the beginning. If you wish, you continue. I mean, that's we do not impose on you our will. But I am, as a director of foreign counterintelligence, see no reason why I should continue to trust this man and expect some results from him. So he's yours. Thank you. That's it.
Kalugin's version of this story is the one that is now accepted in the United States. In Russia, there's a different version.
Kalugin, как агент?
Kalugin himself was a CIA agent. Kalugin was a mole within the KGB. It was his task to neutralize Karl Koecher.
I heard that story emanating from Russia. Mr. Krichkov, my former chief of the Soviet intelligence, who spent 18 months in jail for high treason after an attempt to overthrow Gorbachev, he is the author and mastermind of this version.
За все время работы Калугина.
While Kalugin was head of foreign counterintelligence, we did not expose a single American agent. After we removed Kalugin, we exposed dozens and dozens of our enemies. That fact alone says a lot.
It's absolute rubbish. It's an attempt to, I mean, a typical Soviet-style cheap accusation, which I often take in stride, well, because it also reveals how uninventive they have become.
Kalugin was sentenced in absentia to 14 years. It is now very clear there is evidence.
Kalugin was, I believe, one of the foulest, meanest, most murderous lowlifes in the whole game.
Koecher felt that Kalugin had deliberately set him up to be killed. Fortunately for Koecher, a bloody period in intelligence history had just come to an end, and the intelligence services of both sides, fearing retaliation, had become more reluctant to kill even those they believed to be traitors.
When they were kept telling me that I was an American agent, I said, well, you know, in that case, the CIA would, of course, be looking for me, and it seems that that argument worked. So eventually they let me board a plane to Vienna. And the last words they I heard from them was that you will stop working against us or we will physically liquidate you.
Koecher returned to the United States and withdrew from the world of spying. He found a job teaching at a university, and for 4 years, believed that his career as a spy was over. He was wrong. He would be called back into service as the world edged closer to global nuclear war.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
As the 80s began, the Cold War heated up. Ronald Reagan, America's new president, initiated a series of moves that made the Soviet leadership extremely nervous. Until then, the American nuclear doctrine had been based on the fear of mutually assured destruction. But now, the U.S. began to develop a commanding and potentially destabilizing lead in the arms race.
When Reagan got into the White House, They immediately rewrote the doctrine. They came upon the idea of a limited nuclear war, which would begin with a first strike. And that's very important, which could be won by the United States.
Most people forget how dangerous the 80s were, because it was in the early 1980s that the Soviet Union became convinced the United States was going to conduct a preemptive attack against the Soviet Union. In an operation called Ryan, R-Y-A-N, they told their intelligence officers to look for signals for the nuclear attack. And they then planned a preemptive, bolt from the blue, nuclear attack against the United States.
It was as part of Operation Ryan that Karl Koecher was called in from the cold.
In
1981, when Gladek, the head of Czech intelligence, came to Moscow to meet Vladimir Alexander Khrushchev, who was then head of KGB counterintelligence, only then did we find out, in Gladek's own words, how Koecher had been smeared by Kalugin.
The story of Koecher's misfortune, the story of Koecher's suffering, is a direct result of Kalugin's actions.
They sent an officer to New York, and he apologized in the name of the service, and he talked about the nuclear alert and the need to somehow prevent it. So agreed.
The Soviets were in a state of hair-trigger tension. They expected an attack and were ready to launch their own. A single misunderstanding could have triggered a catastrophe. And Karl Koecher's homeland would be caught in the crossfire.
That was indeed an indication of the degeneration of the Soviet system. Some of the saber-rattling in Washington at the time made the Soviet aging leadership so nervous that they decided that something is brewing and they have to alert their intelligence services, their armed forces, to a potential attack. So it was truly paranoid.
Soviet counterintelligence had field agents who were serious, tested, trustworthy, and reliable. So we knew precisely whether or not the Americans were preparing a surprise nuclear attack on the Soviet Union. And that's why peace was preserved, because of the work of those field agents.
Karl was back in active service. Using his contacts, he provided vital information that fed into a massive global intelligence gathering operation. At the same time, however, it seems that the FBI had somehow learned that he was a spy. From the moment Koecher was reactivated, the FBI was on to him, mounting a round-the-clock surveillance operation.
They had his car bugged, his home bugged, and Hana's place of business bugged for 3 years.
What had happened to give Koecher away to the FBI? Had he become careless and slipped up? Or had he been betrayed?
I think we'll stop that right then. The next thing that comes is David Major telling you that you'll never know what gave him away, because they will never, never reveal a source. Does that give you a sense of looking inside of the intelligence community and trying to sort out the truth, the allegations, the half-truths, the blame? It's a kind of a profound look at what the CIA has always been up against. I would point out, at the end of the day, we stand by Oleg Kalugin. He's our friend, he's a board member, he's an upstanding guy, but what was coming at him there had to be alarming. So what happened after they went back to Czechoslovakia? What happened to Hana? Well, Hana was hired, interestingly, by the British Embassy in Prague. So I think it was a wake-up call for their security apparatus. The Brits let her slide through. In 1994, she was fired because of the publicity about her spying background when that came out. In 1995, the next year, the local press reported that Hana was complaining that publicizing information about her spy activity was damaging her business. The Prague court dismissed her charges, and they really haven't been publicly heard from since then. So that's a little bit of the story of Hana and Karl Koecher and their adventure in the United States, their activities in the intelligence community, and their embarrassment and their expulsion back to Europe. But it doesn't give you a sense of the seriousness of what it was they were up to and the consequences of their activities. So I'm going to talk to you about one case that they impacted directly. It's just one case, and it can be talked about because it's in the public domain. There are other cases that I don't think you're going to hear mentioned in the press. But this is a story of a Russian named Alexander Ogorodnik. It's a famous case. He was a CIA agent, and his code name was Trigon. He was initially spotted when he was working in Bogota, Colombia, as a junior diplomat at their embassy, at the Russian embassy. It was the Colombians who took a look at him and decided he might be ripe for recruitment. He was having some shady dealings of his own. He had a mistress. He could be blackmailed. They always look for things like that. So they approached him. They were having difficulty convincing him that he wanted to work for the West, and they called in the CIA to see if we could do anything with him. There was a very well-known CIA case officer named Jack Downing, who appears again and again in the history of our agency when we need some help. They took Jack Downing down to Bogota. He met with Ogorodnik, and they formed a really wonderful friendship that lasted throughout his career, Ogorodnik's career. Ogorodnik was going to be posted back to Moscow, where it is so hard to run a case, as Peter was alluding to in his opening remarks. It's considered a denied area. Denied area is a part of the world where you won't meet face-to-face with an agent. It's too dangerous. You can't come in contact with an agent. Everything is done impersonally in a denied area. That's why it signals on mailboxes, it's dead drops, it's maybe some encrypted electronics, but you never are face-to-face with an agent because they'll catch him, and if they catch him in Moscow, they'll kill him. So when Trigon was sent to Moscow, his recognition signal to start that case, to make it active in Moscow, was Jack Downing's face. He knew Jack Downing. And there was going to be one brief encounter. He was going to see Jack Downing, and then this whole plan that had been laid on was going to kick in. Jack Downing was in Moscow. He was just getting ready to leave, to go home PCS, when Ogorodnik is reassigned to Moscow. And Jack has to go out on the street to meet him because he is the key. The problem was that Jack, who was the deputy chief of station then, had so much surveillance that he couldn't get free. He couldn't get out on the street. There was no way to step out there without having teams of surveillance all over him. So my husband, Tony Mendez, who was chief of disguise back then, was in Moscow back then that week. He was visiting. And between Tony and Jack, they came up with this plan. There was another person visiting from the United States, a very unique-looking man. He wore a cowboy hat. He wore a big belt, and he had a huge mustache. He was just so distinct. You could spot him a block away. So Jack Downing and Tony Mendez decided that they were going to turn Jack Downing into that guy. They borrowed the hat. They got the mustache out of somebody's disguise thing. They dressed Jack Downing up very much like the visitor, and he went through security and he went out on the street. Nobody cared because he was just a TDY or just a visitor from Washington. And he met with Ogorodnik, and the operation began. This operation, the Trigon operation out of Moscow, which is mentioned in a book for sale here on the back table, it's called The Spy Widow. This was one of the most significant operations the CIA ever ran. It turned out that Trigon, his new assignment when he got to Moscow, was in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And he sat at the connection where all the classified and traffic to all the embassies, the Russian embassies, all over the world, it came in and it went out through his office. And so the CIA is sitting on this incredible gold mine of information and intelligence. This was back when they were doing the START talks, the Strategic Arms Limitation talks in Helsinki. It's been said that the CIA knew the Russians' bottom line in those negotiations before anybody even got off the plane in Helsinki. This was an amazing source of information that we had. To run this operation required the CIA, and my office in particular, the Office of Technical Service, to give the case officers and the agent in Moscow, people like Peter and Trigon, to give them capabilities that they had not had before. This operation was so important. So for instance, we developed a camera. It was called the T-50, and then the next one was the T-100. A camera so small. There's one in this museum. There's one on display up in one of the display cabinets upstairs. So small that you could put it in a key fob, a lipstick, a pin. You could put it in almost anything. And this little camera inside had an even smaller cassette, because it wasn't digital. This was film, right? And the little cassette had the tiniest piece of film in it you ever saw. It was so small that to get film in that cartridge, you had to go to extraordinary efforts. We went to aerial reconnaissance film that the satellites used, which was very thin film, because it's a weight thing. You can't lift that much weight up into space, so everything, every ounce they could save. The aerial reconnaissance film is so thin. Now, I'm a photo operations officer, that in the dark room, when you were putting it on the reels way back then, you couldn't even feel it. And these tiny strips of film, God forbid, if you ever dropped one in the dark room, you would never find it. You couldn't, if you touched it, you couldn't. I'm telling you, we invented a series of cameras and a series of film, and then a way to develop a tiny strip of film, and then a way to print. We collected, with those cameras, eventually, more significant intelligence than any satellite system, any other technical capability, came with my teeny tiny cameras. And I was the gal in the dark room putting the film in and taking it out and developing it and printing it. And the agents that were using it were risking their lives every time they took a shot. That was one set of technical capabilities that we gave to Moscow station. Some others were considered proprietary. They wouldn't be used for any other station in the world. Only Moscow could use some of our technical wherewithal, because we didn't want it exposed anywhere else. We wanted the best, save for Moscow and save for an operation like Trigon. Well, Trigon, he was stellar. Tony always talks about Moscow rules. Moscow rules were invented for a case like Trigon, for a case where you just couldn't do enough to protect this guy. There was a female case officer sent to Moscow whose only job was to handle this case. For her whole assignment, that's all she did. Her name was Marty Peterson, and she wrote The Widow Spy. Her job the whole time she was in Moscow was never to associate with another CIA person outside of the embassy, never to hang out with CIA, never even acknowledge CIA. She went with a bunch of secretaries. They went to the Marine House on Friday nights. She had a completely different profile than a professional CIA officer would have. And what she did, she never met Trigon. and the time she spent there. She just put down dead drops for him and picked up dead drops from him. That's all she did. But one night, she did a 2.5-hour surveillance detection run out of the embassy. She wasn't followed much because she was like a secretary. They didn't care. Besides, they didn't use women, and they thought we didn't use women. So we used a lot of women. She did her 2.5-hour SDR. She was on the subway. She took a taxi. She walked. It was dark at night, making sure that she didn't have surveillance. Because she was going to go out on this bridge over the Moscow River. It's called the Krasnokolusky Bridge. And she had in her purse a thing that looked like a lump of coal. But it wasn't a lump of coal. It was from our office. And you could open it up, and inside there were some rubles. There was some medicine. There were some notes. There were some of those preloaded little cameras for him to take some more photographs from us. She walked out on that bridge. Now think about this. If you're worried about being followed, this is a really good place to see if you're being followed, because you can see 360 degrees around you. And there was no one there. So she took the stone out of her purse. She puts it in a niche in the bridge where he would come looking for it. She turns to walk away, and all of a sudden, she's got 15 Soviets all over her. She was arrested. They came popping up out of nowhere. But of course, they came popping up out of somewhere. And the somewhere was, they had cut an opening in the bridge, and they had hung like a ladder underneath. It was like a bunch of spiders. They were waiting, but they didn't know who they were waiting for. They knew someone was going to come and put something in that bridge that night, and they were going to arrest whoever it was. Well, it was Marty. And they arrested Marty Peterson. It was the end of her career. It was all over in the press the next day. The International Herald Tribune had a picture of her in Lubyanka being interrogated, had pictures of all the stuff that she was going to drop and leave. And then she was persona non grata. She was sent home. But what about Trigon? What happened to Trigon? Well, Trigon had been arrested. He had been arrested because Karl Koecher had been translating some of the documents that he had been providing to the CIA. Not the documents in Moscow, the documents in Bogota. And what they did was a triangulation. Koecher, when he's providing this material to Russia, says, well, this man is obviously, he's married. He served in Bogota from this year to this year. He's been reassigned to Moscow, now we know. And by a process of elimination, they figured out that it was Trigon. So they arrested Trigon, and they asked him to write his confession. When Trigon had met with Jack Downing in Bogota and agreed to work for the CIA, he said back then, I will work for you, but you, in turn, have to give me the wherewithal to take my own life. Because if I am arrested, I don't want to go through what they're going to put me through. I want to know that I have the ability to take my own life if I feel that I need to. The CIA said no. There's something called an L pill, lethal, an L pill. It lived in my office when I was a secretary in the technical services division. It was in a box that had two keys. My boss had one of the keys, and our chief of operations had the other key. You couldn't just like pick up an L pill. It was very, very controlled. The CIA said, no, you can't have that. We don't, you know. It's just an incredibly unique circumstance that we would give one of those things out. And Trigon said, fine, I won't work for you. So eventually he won, and we gave him one of those pills. But we just didn't hand him a pill. We took his favorite Mont Blanc pen, which was a status symbol back there. I don't know if it still is, but they're expensive and they're fabulous. And we took his Mont Blanc pen, and we took the end of the barrel, and we machined it out. So it looked fine from the outside, but it was actually kind of fragile. It was very, very thin, and inside of that was that pill. So when they asked Trigon to to write his confession. He said, I want my pen. Give me my pen. At that point, they had him stripped down to his underwear. He was wearing his shorts and nothing else because they didn't know, didn't trust. They had no idea what was going on. But they were so excited to get this confession that they gave him his pen. And he simply bit down on the end of it. And the Russians in their report say he was dead before he hit the floor. That's the cost of someone like Koecher. And that's basically the end of this prepared talk. Marty Peterson was in jail for 3 days in Lubyanka. She left the country. The Soviets waited a year before they announced the death of Trigon. It was in 1978. All went back to the Koechers. That was one case of what happened based on their activities. And so I think what we'll do is take questions. If anybody has any questions, I bet they do. And my favorite guy with the mic over here, Peter, is going to field them.
Okay, Jonna, thank you for a wonderful presentation on a fascinating case. If I could just add a footnote to this wonderful retelling of the case. When Koecher was in the unit that was reading transcriptions from bugging operations, telephone taps, and so forth, I was in SE Division. And one of my functions at that time was working with the FBI on double agent cases. And also, I was part of the training crew. And I had occasion to go down and train these folks who were doing this transcribing in how to read those differently than just the language. In other words, what is the meta meaning of what you're reading? What is really going on? Are people talking in code? Is there a tension? Can you detect tension? And so he was part of the group that I trained. And I will tell you, he did not have the word spy written across his forehead. He was just part of the group there. So, John, that was terrific. I was in on the recruitment of Koecher from the headquarters end. It was very exciting because it was so rare for us to have a success in that kind of case. So thank you so much for recapturing that. Questions, and if you'd be kind enough to wait for the mic, everyone can hear it. Right here, let's take the first one.
I remember back in seeing the big Washington Post story on Marty's neighborhood, and I worked with the woman that had done her BI, and of course the Washington Post identified that woman as a FBI officer, agent. But anyway, I can't remember the reasons that the agency let Koecher go in, was it 75, 76? I seem to remember that we could fire him for swinging back then, and I can't remember if that was the reason given, or was there another reason?
I'm not sure that the agency knew that was going on when it was going on, the swinging part. I don't think that anybody officially connected to the United States government was taking that information in, that they were engaged in that kind of thing. And I don't think that the CIA was particularly looking for that kind of thing. Is that your experience, Peter?
No, I think you're correct. And I frankly don't recall that he was let go for cause. I think there was concern, and he was let go. But I'd have to go back and read into the case again, because obviously he was out there, even though the Bureau was still trying to be alert to what he was up to. So, as you know, they stayed on here. Sorry?
He left employment long before the Bureau got onto him.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
So I was just wondering, I couldn't remember what did he leave of his own accord, or
yeah,
he was
and
go?
I don't remember either. Okay, sorry. Okay. Other questions on, here's one right over here. Oh, here, right here, Laura, and then we'll take the one in the back. Right here? Sure.
Can you hear me? So the coaches were hired by the Czech intelligence in the early 1960s, which still was the Dubček's government. while they were in the United States, the Soviet Union invaded Prague. So I wonder if the Koecher's attitude was more loyalty to the old Czech or Czechoslovakia than the one that became more cooperative with the Soviet Union.
That's actually a wonderful question, and I have no information on that. I would think that they were old school. They were raised in that culture. They were raised in that society, but I can't speak to that. I don't know.
And as Jonna mentioned, they underwent training before they ever came to the States. This is really a classic case of a mole. That is, they were trained, sent here to insert themselves into society, and eventually, of course, he applied for employment at the... I think he applied elsewhere, too, besides the CIA, if I recall.
He may
in the
have.
Community. But the idea was to get a job in what we now call the intelligence community. Yes. Yeah. Well, and of course, the Soviet Union very much was sort of the senior among equals. In other words, over the East European intelligence services, and hence that's why Oleg was brought in, Oleg Kalugin. And my recollection is, you've just looked over the case more recently than I have. Wasn't Trigon first surfaced with Oleg in that meeting? I think so. And of course, the reason that Karl shown these pictures didn't know these people is he wasn't dealing with them directly. He was looking at recordings of these people, having the transcripts from bugging operations or telephone transcripts. And so it was an interesting. Talking right past each other.
Had you seen that video before? I thought that was a fascinating piece.
No, I have not seen this one.
Piece of film.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, if Oleg Kalugin walked into my office and said, I'm from counterintelligence, KGB, and I'd like to have a chat with you, you know, he's quite the character in that role.
Okay. There's one right back here, yes.
Was Hannah as vehemently anti-Semitic as her husband? I mean, she works in the diamond industry, which is...
Good point.
I have another question, too.
I don't think even Karl was anti-Semitic. I think that was his posture that he presented for consumption, this dissident guy, this intellectual guy, this very outspoken... You know, you see him in that tape, a little older, much more moderated. But the one you read about wasn't a moderate man at all. And Hana, in all the interviews, in all the recorded interviews with Hana, she was very much in love with her husband. And she was, if he was anti-communist, she was anti-communist. Of course, he wasn't. But whatever he was, she was right there with him, mimicking, going along with it. Yeah, he wasn't anti-Semitic. He said... He's an atheist, and the real Karl Koecher, if there was such a thing, was an atheist.
And his defection in Austria, was he a walk-in to the embassy? Did he defect to the Austrians or to the Americans? Where'd that happen?
I think he moved to Vienna. He lived in Vienna, and he simply got on a plane in Vienna and came here and said, I'm fleeing from Czechoslovakia. I stopped in Vienna, but I am fleeing from Czechoslovakia, looking for a new home. Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't an outright dramatic defection. They sought asylum in the U.S. like you get with many refugees. When they got here, they indicated they had cause to flee, and so it was not a great, defection with headlines and so forth. Let me take one more over here, Laura, and then we'll come right back here. You got one? All right, why don't we take that one? We'll take the one over here.
This is a little different perspective, but... When Reagan came in to be president, the Soviets had quite a bit of paranoia about a preemptive attack. And I believe it was a military operation in 1983 or 84, it may have been NATO forces, in which the Soviets felt that this was a beginning of a preemptive attack. Somebody, I don't know if it was MI, the British intelligence or the CIA, who said, picked up the intelligence and said, we need to stand down or something like that. Do you recall that at all?
I do not. I do not.
Not precisely, no. It was, as David said, it was a very tense period with fears on both sides. And so you did have that. We had, of course, the Cuban Missile Crisis much, much earlier, and then a similar crisis in the early 80s. Yes. One over here.
Do we know if the two of them are still alive and where they are? And have they ever really just sort of done interviews recently that sort of bring all this to light?
I looked, and I couldn't find anything. I can't find any more interviews, and I can't find any indication that they are not alive.
Jonna, it's Amanda.
Yes.
But she was working for the English embassy in Prague, right?
We can track them up to 95. She was working for the British embassy in Prague, which was
And just, they didn't realize she was...
Evidently, the blow up about them, the news, it just didn't get any traction back in Czechoslovakia, and so they were little known actually, and there wasn't a lot of press.
All right.
And the Brits didn't realize who was working for them. Was
no.
The great punch.
How about right here, Amanda, and then we'll go back over there.
Here,
you can get over there.
There is an aspect that is somewhat tangential, but something of great interest. When the fall of Antonin Novotny led to the Prague Spring, and there was the debate as to how much of a threat the Prague Spring posed to Brezhnev, and would you possibly know, did the Czech intelligence service continue its cooperation during the Prague Spring, or were there any signs that Dubček's government was minimizing or getting away from cooperating with Soviet intelligence as we got into the Prague summer?
That's a fascinating question, and I would like to know the answer to your question, but I don't have the answer to your question.
Yeah, no, I think if Dubček had lived, you would have seen that. But that, too, was a very tense period. And when you have political change like that, there's often the old guard that you're contending with, as you had in Moscow as well, which Kalugin was talking about. Kalugin was indeed sentenced in absentia, and he was smeared, charging him with having given up secrets and so on, which he had not. Kalugin was not even a defector. Kalugin came here on, as I recall, I think it was an AT&T contract, and it just, as many of these things do, it didn't take off, and he chose to stay on. Good thing.
You know, it's okay. Hard to track some of these things back historically when you can see from that bit of tape how history can be manipulated just depending on who you're asking the question of. It gets harder and harder to find, really, where is the truth?
Yes. Other questions?
We've got one. Peter?
Yes.
One right here?
Thank you.
This is almost a dumb question.
No dumb questions.
I teach a course in aspects of espionage at the University of Delaware Senior Center every fall. This will be my sixth year. And no matter what I lecture on for the 10 weeks, they end up asking me questions about what they see on television, unfortunately. But most of the time I can make fun of it. That's easy. But now there's been a program called The Americans, and it's been written up quite a bit in the Post, and I watched it again the other night, and about one-third of it, do you know the program I'm talking about?
I do, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, because I get asked about it too, but go ahead.
Yeah. All right. About one-third of it is pretty good operationally, and until I saw the Kirchner thing, I thought this was coming out of nowhere, but... What would your opinion be? Was the Kirchners perhaps some sort of symbol or something of what the Americans ended up doing?
Well, are many of you familiar with the Americans? Yeah. All right, you're about to be challenged with another program called Allegiance,
yeah.
Which is an illegals couple living in America, ta-da-da-da. In the case of the American, did you want to, this is your show, so I'm going to respond.
I would mention that there will be a piece on ABC Sunday morning, this coming Sunday, They came out and interviewed Tony. I know they've interviewed Sandy Grimes. I'm not sure. I think maybe the CIA gentleman behind the Americans, Weissman.
Yes. Yeah.
I believe he was also interviewed about this kind of phenomenon of these shows that are based on former CIA employees. That's the point of the show on Sunday. But it's ABC. It's Martha Raddatch, yeah. George Stephanopoulos. So they'll be addressing that. The thing that strikes me is the enduring popularity of this subject. I find it amazing.
Yeah. What you have, and many of you will remember in 2010, they arrested 10 Russians living here as what we considered illegals. And if you recall, they traded them back, they being us, the U.S., for four people that they had imprisoned, charging them with being our sources. It was a fascinating exchange. It reminds you of the Department of Agriculture catch and release program for fish. You know, catch them and you release them. So the what you saw recently is the arrest of an individual in New York in the banking industry living as an illegal. That is, he was undeclared. He was not declared as a foreign agent. He happened to be Russian. His two handlers were in the now Russian embassy. In the case of the Americans, the big distinction that I see in it is there were illegals in this country. People sent, sometimes the term sleeper agent is used. Typically, they are kept for handling a very sensitive operation, or in wartime, they being sleeper agents, they are there behind the lines. We have never seen illegals engaged in the range of activity that you have in the Americans, or that you will see in this forthcoming series called Allegiance. But, I mean, and I'll use the term loosely, it's Hollywood. In other words, that is, it has to be a dramatic program. But as you say, often the tradecraft is quite good. And you will see that to a degree in Allegiance as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Look forward to it.
Okay. There are no dumb questions. Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
This. I'm
trying to see the hands. Go ahead, Laura. Here we are, right here.
So, you mentioned that as a CIA employee, you were involved in a lot of very intricate inventions.
Yes.
So, are any of the CIA technical inventions later transferred into the industry, similar to how NASA's inventions sometimes make it to the industry, or you keep it all to yourselves?
The question was, working in the Office of Technical Service, where we developed a lot of unique proprietary kinds of materials and techniques, did any of it ever make it into commercial technology? And the answer is yes, and I'll just give you one example because of time constraints, but batteries. We had people who spent their entire lives on batteries. That's all they did, batteries. One of them became so famous, George Methley, that one of the schools at CIA, there are four schools, one of them is named the George Methley School. So batteries paid off in the end. But our particular problem, if you can imagine it, is we needed smaller and smaller and smaller and more power. If you're going to put a bug in the conference table of the Politburo in Moscow and put it up under, say, the conference table and plant it or put it in the woodwork like they did in State Department in the chair railing, do you think you're going to ever get in to change the batteries in that thing? You are not. It is only going to last as long as it lasts. And so you need these little, small, teeny, tiny, and I mean very small, very strong. Those came out into hearing aids. That technology came out into battery watches. Those small, small batteries that are used today are based on research and development that was done at CIA. There are a lot of small things like that translated. Thank you for the question.
Okay. All right, once again, Jonna, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
A wonderful presentation. Okay, good.
Thank you.
And thank you all so much for coming today and joining us. Have a good rest of your day.